Today's reading is taken from Mark chapter 9, verses 17 to 27, and can be found on page 1013 in the Pew Bibles. A man in the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." "O unbelieving generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell on the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It has often thrown him into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." "If I can," said Jesus. "Everything is possible for him who believes." Immediately, the boy's father exclaimed, "I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the evil spirit. "You deaf and mute spirit," he said, "I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. This is the word of the Lord.
Morning, everyone.
I need the... there it is. So, yes, the theme of this morning's talk is from belief to faith. And just remind ourselves of that bit of the passage. The key line or the key phrase that I'm preaching on this morning is about, "I believe, how my unbelief." So he asked his father, "How long has this been happening?" So Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And often it's thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." here we are, yes. So Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." It feels a somewhat strange statement by the father. "I believe, help my unbelief." Almost contradictory. So you sort of think, well, do you believe or don't you? Do you believe that Jesus can do this or not? And sometimes in the Bible we see sort of this conflict between, a tussle between faith and doubt. So a good example would be Thomas. Thomas was obviously a man of faith because he was a disciple. He gave up his life to follow Jesus, so he's a man of faith. But when it comes to believing in the resurrection, he was... he doubted. But in some ways, this conflict we see here, "I believe, have my unbelief," is not just a conflict between faith and doubt. It's more of a conflict between belief and faith. The man has belief. If he didn't have belief, he wouldn't be there. He wouldn't be in front of Jesus if he didn't have some belief. And yet, as he is aware himself, he lacks something. And the thing he lacks is faith, because the word he says to Jesus is this. He says, "If." Steve. Is it not? Oh, there we go. Is it not? Is it not? All right. So the word he says, if you can do anything. Now this contrasts with the great statements of faith, like the Roman centurion who goes to Jesus and he says, you just say the word and I believe it will happen. It will happen because, you know, he had a man of great faith. But here is a man who's struggling, not so much with belief and doubt, but the struggle between belief and faith. The man uses the word if, doesn't he? And Jesus picks up on this. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. But when we're starting to think about, talking about what is possible, we are putting our belief into action, and that requires faith. So there's this jump from belief into faith. So I want to give a couple of illustrations of this. here we are. Right, okay. So a couple of illustrations. Right, so illustration number one. A friend of mine went on holiday to Greece a few years ago and had a really good time. It was just a Greek island and it was good. There were no fires or heat waves. But all good things come to an end. And so he headed back to the airport with his wife and his son. And small island, small airport, one runway, one terminal. And, you know, plane flies in to the airport, drops off passengers, drops off luggage, picks up passengers, picks up luggage, takes them back home again. So they're waiting at the terminal in the departure lounge. They can see the plane come in, see the passengers get off, see the luggage get off, and think, well, we'll be going on soon. After which, there is an announcement. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid there is a delay due to a slight technical issue, So they're scratching their heads thinking, well, I wonder what that is. At which point, this battered old van drives up to the runway, drives up to the plane, parks by the engine, and two men get out with a sort of tatty, oil-stained overalls, remove part of the engine casing, and start sort of fiddling around with this engine. At which point, several people in the departure lounge start to become a bit unnerved. And there's this sort of murmurings of discontent around this departure lounge, and people saying, I'm not getting on that plane. Who are these guys? Yeah, they look like they're qualified to work on nothing more sophisticated than a Ford Fiesta, but they're there messing with something like a Rolls-Royce RB211. You know, I'm not getting on that plane. My friend said he was quite phlegmatic about it because, in a sense, either you get on that plane or you wait a week for the next one or you make your own way back to the country. So, eventually, people were sort of coerced into getting back onto the plane. And eventually, they put the casing back, they drove off, and people began to board the plane. Now, you might believe that these men, despite the van, despite their tatty van, despite their appearance, were actually qualified to work on this engine. You might believe that, but to get on that plane and fly on a plane requires something else. That requires faith. Because when you're 30,000 feet in the air, and maybe you're sitting near the engine and you glance over it, you're thinking, I hope these guys know what they're doing. You know, I hope they are qualified. Because you need, to get onto that plane, you need faith. The second illustration is from the new film Oppenheimer. And as you probably know, there's no spoiler alerts here, as you probably know, they're working on the Manhattan Project to produce an atomic weapon. And they've done all the sums, basically. They've done all the sums, and the sums tell them that, yes, there will be a big explosion. This atomic weapon will cause a big explosion. But there's one little doubt. They've never actually tested this atomic weapon. And the doubt is this, that it will start a chain reaction that will not stop. So there is a chance that when they detonate this bomb, it will obliterate not just a little part of New Mexico, where the test range is, but the whole of the planet. Because there will start off this fission reaction, and there's no guarantee it won't stop. The sums say that shouldn't happen. But you don't know, they didn't know until they've pressed the button. So in this shot from the film, the General Groves, played by Matt Damon, And Oppenheimer is just explaining to him this sort of quandary. Well, you know, the sums all add up, but until we press that button and detonate that bomb, we won't know if it won't just create a huge crater or obliterate planet Earth. So Matt Damon says, well, what are the chances? Oppenheimer says, well, it's near zero. Well, you know, how near zero? How near zero is this that we're just going to wipe out mankind with this bomb? It's pretty, you'll be all right. So again, there's this leap between belief and faith. They've got all the sums, they've done all the sums. They've even got Einstein to check the sums over. Yeah, it all adds up. Don't want anything to worry about. But until you press that button, you don't know. So there's that leap from belief into faith. So belief is good, and it's certainly not wrong to have belief, but in a sense, it's not enough in itself. Perhaps we should see it more as being like a springboard to faith. The 2021 census, we have a census in this country every 10 years, and part of the census is to ask people about their religious beliefs. And you were probably aware in the news that in the 2021 census, people made a big thing that the number of people who identified as Christian had dropped below 50%. Oh, it's a drop on the last census and whatever. It's below 50%, 50, you know, only 46% identify as Christian. But 46% is still a lot of people. That's 27.5 million people in this country who say they identify as Christian. 27.5 million people who would, therefore, say they have a belief. So, where are all these people? You know, if all these people started coming to church, we'd have to have five services on a Sunday. You'd have to book ahead to get a seat. So there's more, so belief in itself is something, if it leads to something, if it leads to faith, it's good. Belief in itself isn't really anything to write home about. Ticking a box isn't just enough. Belief in itself is not enough. And in James, the Apostle James mentions this in his letter, in chapter 2 of the letter of James. What good is it, brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say to you, I have faith, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. And then there's this line, you believe that there is one God, good, even the demons believe that and shudder. So here, James almost ridicules the idea of faith without deeds. Faith without action is nothing. You know, like he says, well, you believe, well, big deal, even demons believe that there's a God. What good does your belief do in itself? Faith without action is nothing. It's the difference between believing something but pulling that belief into action. It's the difference between theory and practice. Anyone who has learned to drive and has gone through the process of learning to drive or has learned to drive will understand that you have to take a theory test. You have to go to an exam room, answer multiple choice questions. You have to take a theory test. But that in itself is not enough. The DVLA don't say, well, great, you've passed this theory test. We're confident that you are able to get in behind the wheel of a car and drive it safely. You have to prove for a physical test like this one that you are fit to drive. Theory alone isn't enough. And as James says himself, belief itself isn't enough. I believe. Yeah, great, even the demons believe there's a God. But you need to act in faith. You need to step on that plane. You need to put your beliefs into action. When I became a Christian, I would have been 18. And I was going to a Methodist church. My family went to the Methodist church. And They had arranged for a mission to come to our church. So a team of young people from Cliff College. If anyone's heard of Cliff College, it's a Methodist training college in Derbyshire, a theological college. And they came to our church for a week and did various mission and outreach things. And one of them, we hosted one of them, a guy called Alan, and he was from Northern Ireland. And having him with us was a real eye-opener, because I could definitely say at the time that I was a believer, but I could see that Alan was different. He was a Christian. We shared the same beliefs. If he sat down and asked us what we believed, our beliefs probably would have matched up. But he was a Christian, and I wasn't. I believed in Jesus. He had a relationship with Jesus. He was a follower of Jesus. His beliefs shaped his life. Mine didn't. So I was at that time, my unbelief moment. I began to understand that my belief in itself wasn't enough. And it was a big step on my journey to faith. I had to come to terms, like I said, with my own I believe how my unbelief moment. I had to come to terms that there was this disparity between myself, who was a churchgoer and a believer, and Alan, who was a Christian. I had belief, he had faith. So belief is good, it's a positive thing to believe. But as we see so many times in the Bible, that belief needs to be transformed into faith. Jesus seeks out disciples, not just believers. And time and again, Jesus commands those who have faith. The Roman centurion, like I said, Jesus said, I haven't seen faith like this in the whole of Israel. The woman who comes to Jesus and touches his cloak, she's suffering with internal bleeding. He says to her, you know, your faith has healed you. So belief can be a start on that journey of faith. But there needs to be a transformation in our lives from people who believe to people of faith. Learning to trust in God is a continuous day-by-day process. We hear stories of conversion, of people giving their lives to Jesus. Many of you here will have your own conversion stories, which is great. Your own testimonies, and you've shared your testimonies. That's fantastic. And absolutely, we need to accept Christ as our Savior, and we absolutely need to make that step. That's what we call justification, that step of making ourselves right with Christ, accepting his sacrifice. But now we are right with God. However, faith is an ongoing thing. It's day by day. It's putting your trust in God, putting your belief in action. People have likened faith to being like a muscle. The more you use it, the more it grows, the more it develops. And by contrast, if you don't use your muscles, if you're inactive, then they die. And we might feel that, well, we've only got a very small amount of faith. Obviously, people like vicars and people who are the Pace team and people like Alan Saunders, they must have amazing amounts of faith, so they do amazing things. We've only got a very small amount of faith. But as you can see from this last slide, as Jesus said, faith like a mustard seed can move a mountain. Faith, if you put into action, even if you believe you only have a tiny and little amount of faith, if you put that faith into action, then I believe you will see amazing things happen and your faith will grow. There's so much to say about faith. I mean, this sermon itself is not a sermon about faith. It's more about the transition from belief to faith. Faith in itself, you could do a whole series of sermons about faith, but it's about using it. We might be fearful that, oh, we've only got a very small amount of faith. We're not like missionaries and vicars and evangelists, and people go out and they do amazing things and they've got amazing testimonies of what happened. We've only got a very small amount of faith. But as the Bible says, you know, overcoming that fear, and as it says in this slide, I have a mustard seed and I'm not afraid to use it. I have only a very tiny amount of faith, but I will use it. So we can go from that journey from belief to faith, like the man who comes to Jesus with his son, who acknowledges that he has belief, but also acknowledges that he's lacking something. He needs, and what he needs is faith. So that's all what I wanted to share with you this morning, just that thought about putting your faith into action. Don't worry that you feel you've only got a very small amount. Put into action what you have, and you will see God, that God is faithful, and you know those who put their faith in him will be blessed. Amen.